Welcome to the explainer. You know, today we're going to do something pretty cool. We are going to build an entire national economy, right from scratch. We'll put it together, piece by piece, using the fundamental rules of national accounting, and you'll see just how neatly it all fits. So let's just dive right in with a big question, right? How in the world do you measure the economy of an entire nation? I mean, it sounds impossibly huge and complicated, but what you're about to see is that there's actually a beautiful, elegant logic to the whole thing.
Okay, so where do we start? Well, every good structure needs a solid foundation. And for an economy, that foundation is what we call its product, basically the total value of everything that gets created by everyone, from businesses to the government.
And the absolute key concept here is something called value added. Think about it like this. A baker buys some flour for a dollar and then sells a loaf of bread for $3. Now, did they create $3 of new value? No. They added $2 of value to that flour. And that's what national accounting is all about. It's just adding up all that new wealth that's created, step by step, across the whole economy.
So that brings us to our first big number, the net domestic product, or NDP. It's actually really simple. You just take all the value added by the business sector and you add it to all the value added by the government. That's it. It's just the sum of those two big pieces.
All right, let's start putting some real numbers to this. For our little model economy, let's say the entire business sector, we're talking everything from giant corporations to your corner coffee shop, creates a total value added of 2,500 million. Got it? 2,500. Let's lock that in.
Okay. Now for the government's part. This is a little different, right? The government doesn't really sell things. So how do we measure its value added? Well, we do it by looking at what it pays its employees, you know, people like teachers, firefighters, city planners. For our economy, let's say that number is 700 million. So you do the simple math, 2,500 from businesses plus 700 from the government, and that gives us a net domestic product of 3,200 million. But here's the first big aha moment. That number, 3,200, is also the total national income. And why is that? Think about it. Every single dollar of value that's produced has to go somewhere, right? It ends up as income for someone, either as wages for an employee or profits for a company owner. Product and income, they're literally two sides of the very same coin.
Okay, so we've got our national income nailed down. Now let's grab the next piece of our economic puzzle, government activity. We're going to see how its spending and its budget fit into this whole thing. So when we talk about government spending, or public consumption, if you want to use the fancy economist term, it's really made of two parts. First, there's that $700 million it pays its own people, which we already talked about. And second, there's what it buys from private businesses. We're talking computers, cars, materials to build roads, you name it. Let's say that's another $350 million. So you add those two together, and you get a total for public consumption, which economists just call G, of 1,050 million. That number represents the government's direct spending footprint right on the economy. Okay, let's take a peek at the government's budget. And honestly, it's not that different from your own household budget. You've got money coming in, for them, that's mostly taxes, and you've got money going out, which is that public consumption we just figured out. Now, to get the government's real income, you can't just add up all the taxes. It's a bit more nuanced. See, you start with all the tax money coming in, sure, but then you have to subtract the money the government gives back to people without buying a good or service. Think things like Social Security or unemployment benefits. Economists call these transfer payments. So once you make that adjustment, you get what's called net tax revenue, or T. And in our case, that's 1,300 million. And with these two numbers, we can finally see if the government is in the black or in the red. Is it running a surplus or a deficit? All you do is check its net income, T, and subtract its spending, G. It's basically the national version of you checking your bank account at the end of the month.
And look at that. In our little economy, the government is running a surplus. It brought in $1,300, it spent $1,050, which means it saved $250 million. Now remember that number, $250. That's our first big pool of savings.
All right, so we've sorted out the government slice of the pie. But what about everybody else? What about the households? Let's figure out how much money people actually have left over to either spend or save. And that, my friends, is called disposable income.
Disposable income, I mean, it's way more than just some number on a spreadsheet. This is the cash that actually ends up in our pockets after all the taxes are paid and after businesses have kept their share of the profits. This is the stuff that fuels pretty much the entire consumer economy.
So how do we get to that number?
Well, we go back to our big national income number, $3,200. From that, we subtract all the taxes people paid. Then we add back in those transfer payments from the government we talked about earlier. And finally, we have to subtract the profits that businesses kept for themselves to reinvest. That's called business savings. You do all that, and what are you left with? $1,440 million. That is the total disposable income for all the households in our economy.
So people have $1,440 million in their pockets. What do they do with it? Well, in our model, they spend almost all of it. $1,400 million goes right back into the economy as consumption. And that little bit left over, that $40 million, that's what they save. And boom, that's our second pool of savings.
Okay, we have all the pieces. The government piece, the household piece. Now it's time for the grand finale. Let's put this whole thing together and watch how it all balances out. It's actually pretty amazing.
Okay, let's think about this from a different angle. We know the total size of the pie, our NDP, is 3,200. And we know who ate which slices. We know people consumed 1,400, and we know the government consumed 1,050. So what happened to the rest of it? There's a piece missing. Well, that last piece is what we call investment, stuff like building new factories or buying new machinery. And for the math to work, for everything to balance, investment has to be 750.
Now, hold on. Let's switch gears and look at this from the savings side. Remember all those little pools of savings we found along the way? We had the $40 million that people saved. We had the $250 million the government saved. And we had the $460 million that businesses saved.
So what happens if we add all those up? Let's see, 40 plus 460 plus 250. That gives us a grand total for national savings of 750 million. Hey, wait a second. Doesn't that number sound familiar? And there it is. That's the big reveal. The 750 million that everyone saved is exactly equal to the 750 million that was invested. This isn't magic, and it's not a coincidence. It's the most fundamental rule in all of macroeconomics. It has to balance. By definition, every single dollar that gets saved in an economy provides a dollar for someone else to invest.
This beautiful balance, this simple idea that savings equals investment, it's really the bedrock of how we understand an economy. But think about this for a second. Our entire model, this whole perfect system we built, it was a closed economy. No trading with other countries. So what happens when you open the doors? What do imports and exports do to this perfect balance? Well, that's a question for another time.
Thank you.